tape because all the sheriff's department calls it tape. It doesn't bother me. They
Okay.
You always figure they know everything anyway.
Yeah.
How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good, Ted. How are you doing?
Well, I'm hanging in there. I just got the bug last week and wanted to chat with you briefly because we have been away for a long time.
Yeah, right.
And,
Right, how are things going for you over there?
Well, quite well, quite frankly. I was just talking to someone the other day, and the experience of coming over here is one of those, those good things, bad things, bad things. I wouldn't, if I hadn't come over here, I probably wouldn't be looking at a new trial in the Carol Durange case.
Yeah.
And a whole number of things have opened up, and I suppose that, if I have to spend several years behind bars, might as well spend a little here, a little there.
Yeah,
you know?
Kind of get a little variety, huh?
Right, right.
Yeah. They treating you pretty good?
Well, yeah. Yeah, sure they are. It's,
That's good.
They've developed this paranoia about me. They have this unrealistic fear that I'm going to escape or so.
I can't imagine where they're getting that.
Yes, exactly. Let's see. I just wanted to call you up. Mainly, there's a lot of things have been happening. I had that escape adventure, which caused a great furor of activity around here, and
mm-hmm.
I guess some publicity over there. And
yeah.
Now we're looking at what looks like a 95% chance of a new trial in the Carol Durange case.
Mm-hmm.
And while this case over here gets curiouser and curiouser because they've added a couple of additional Utah transactions, alleged transactions, in their attempt to gain a conviction in the Colorado case.
Yeah.
I don't know. I've been so overwhelmed by work recently that, there's just a lot to do. But, way back when I was... Oh, I guess it was back in April when I decided to represent myself in this case. I was just thinking to myself, I can hear Al think, yeah, I knew we'd try to do something like that.
I knew you would.
Well, I remember one time you commented, I can't remember whether something I read in your report. I think it may have been something I read in one of your reports, quite frankly. That I can't delegate responsibility or something to that effect. I don't know. I don't think it's exactly the way you put it, but...
Yeah, I can't remember.
But something more or less that I like to, do things myself and have a hard time entrusting things to others. I can't remember how you...
Yeah, high achievement.
I'm not sure. Yeah, anyway, and I was just...
Uh-huh.
Well, I'm just wondering, and I know you're really at arm's length on this thing, and, we haven't really... taught personally, obviously, since the latter part of January.
Yeah, right.
But any impressions about all that you've been hearing about me and
okay, how do you mean?
Well, like the escape and everything. I wonder what your impression of that was. Just from a party who knows me, but who didn't have an opportunity to speak to me either just before or after that happened.
Yeah, right. Yeah, this is something. It'd be fun to sit down and chat with you about an hour. I had mixed impressions. I was wondering if you were really getting uptight,
mm-hmm.
and the pressure looked like it was on,
mm-hmm.
And I was wondering if it was getting look like in your mind that you were going to be convicted, so when the opportunity was there, and you just took it, believe.
Yeah.
I'd like to have been able to sit down with you before and after to see,
after anyway.
Right. Just to see what was happening. Yeah. What? In your own mind, what was happening?
Was
the reason for
it? I'd given it a great deal of thought. I'd been moved from Aspen, been in the Aspen, Pitkin County Jail, which is in Aspen, from January 31st until April the 11th, which is 73 days. I have all this memorized, And in Aspen, I was an open affair. The jail is very small. It's 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 cells, and you know, and all the doors were open all the time. The place had been built in 1887. But it was just, you know, here is where I could come out and we could relate to talk to other prisoners going in their cell. You know, something like at the state prison, not like Mecca in the mainline.
Mm-hmm.
And then they moved me down here. This is prior to the escape, because I was a security risk, and they put me in a 6x12x8-foot-high cell and ordered no one to speak to me. And quite frankly, that's when I decided to represent myself.
Oh,
at least I got to, you know, get out to go to the library, you know.
Yeah.
There's only situations where, you know, concrete, a solid steel door with a little window and the food slot. I mean, this is worse than the hole, honestly, Al. This is worse than the hole.
Yeah.
In Max, because there you can at least talk to people and see people.
Uh-huh.
And it's worse than Max because they never let, they have to exercise except for the 6 days I was out on escape since the 11th of April.
Uh-huh.
So, this was building up and building up and building up. And I had, over the months, I had noticed a number of opportunities to just walk right out. But I didn't know quite how to put it all together. I was, as you say, I was very concerned about what people would think.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't, you know, people say, weren't you afraid people that someone would shoot you or something? So, no, the last, it was one of the lower fears in my... higher years.
Yeah.
But I don't know, that day I came there and I thought a great deal about escape and I didn't know if I had the guts to do it, quite frankly.
Mm-hmm.
And the guard went outside for a smoke and there's not a one person in the whole courtroom. You'd have to see the courthouse in Aspen. There's, the windows were open and the fresh air was blowing through and the sky was blue. And I said, I'm ready to go, and I walked to the window and jumped out.
Yeah.
And I started chugging. And I had no plan. I had nobody helping me. I had no money. I had no nothing.
Yeah.
And just ran right up into the mountains.
Huh.
But anyway, you know, when I was recaptured, they brought me back in. And they, you know, I spoke very freely about my adventures during those 6 days because, you know, it was something I really couldn't deny. But one of the investigators been working came into the room after I'd been there for some time and said, would you like to talk about the Campbell case? Would you like to tell me all about it now, Ted? You know, more or less, would you want to confess and all this stuff? Because, I mean, I could see the twinkle in his eyes that, you know, he thought that I panicked and now the jig was up and I was ready to bust open. And I told him, I said, Mike, listen, I jumped out of the window because I want to be free. I 2 years ago I could have walked out of a courthouse and, you know, no one would have charged me with any crime. No one would even have noticed. As far as I was concerned, I was just what belonged to me. And
mm-hmm.
It wasn't a fear of conviction. It wasn't, you know, because I believe then, and I believe more firmly now, that I will be acquitted. And and not only that, but I'll get a new trial in Durant. The irony of it all, Al, is that probably the only offense that they will ever get a solid conviction on me will be the escape.
Yeah, right.
But, I told him, as honest to God, I just got sick and tired of being locked up. And I thought, you know, because way back then I knew that I had this new evidence on Durant, although I hadn't given it to anybody yet, wondering what to do with it. And I knew that the case for me here was good, that the case they had was weak. But I kept saying to myself, Ted, in the event that you're acquitted here in Colorado and you go back to Utah, and let's say you get a new trial in Durant, which I estimate would take 3 years, because even if we win at the trial court level with a new trial, the state will appeal, and if the Supreme Court overturns, we'll have to go to the federal court, and the federal courts take years and years. And
yeah.
Even if I got a new trial in Durant 3 years from... you know, there's a chance I could be convicted just basically on the publicity of the whole thing. I mean, I'm pretty notorious. And, you know, if I was acquitted 3-4 years from now in Durant's case, what would I have left? You know, maybe unrealistically, but I asked myself, could you go to law school? Could you live? Could you, you know, look, would your friends be able to look you in the eye? Could you be Ted Bundy again? And I figured, you know, whether you're free tomorrow or whether you're free 4 years from now, you're still going to have to make an entirely new life and really hide from your old life, whether you legitimately or illegitimately.
Yeah.
So those are the priorities then. And
mm-hmm.
I wasn't up against the wall. I mean, it was something I could have done then. So something I could have waited to do. But it was just, I honestly just fed, you know, way up above my chin with being locked up.
Right.
Yeah, just one of those things.
Yeah.
But I just, there's still the scars and the blisters on my feet. I'm sitting here barefooted from running around in the mountains. An extraordinary experience, because I had thought that I'm a pretty strong-willed person. But, you know, believe it or not, it was the body that was strong, but the mind that was weak. But the morning after, well, I ran up, you know, like 4,000 feet of very steep hill, actually Aspen on the other side, and they didn't know where in the world I was, and I was feeling really good that evening, and I started hiking up, and if I kept on hiking, I would have been long gone, but a very cold sleet and rainstorm hit me, and I got very cold, and then I went into a state of shock, and managed to find a cabin. And the cabin was just, you know, there was no way to get into it. And here I was shivering and hungry and cold. It was raining and blowing. And early the next morning, like 7 o'clock in the morning, and I was just sitting there, seriously considering giving myself up. And it was just a complete mind blow for me.
Yeah.
Just longed for freedom for so long. And now, like I was living my ultimate dream, all of a sudden I was willing to throw it away because I was cold and hungry. And I said, my Lord. But I got in the cabin and recuperated, believe it or not, and had a second chance at it. And then I made the wrong turn, and then I hurt my knee, and 3-4 days of high altitude and cold got to me, and again, my mind got weak. And it really kind of, again, when I was recaptured, I just stood there. I mean, I was just, that night, I walked back into Aspen. No one knew me. People saw me. No one could recognize me. But I just was totally disoriented. It was like an experience I've never known before. I just laid down like an animal ready to die. I mean, just it was just an incredible experience, and I was disoriented, and you know, quite frankly, I hopped in a car and just drove. I knew I'd get caught. I mean, I didn't want to get caught, but I knew it would happen. But I was just so tired, and
the best of the alternatives.
Yeah, and I just said, well, just to see what happens, and a fluke, actually, they stopped me. But, you know, anyway, that was one of the more profound experiences of the...
Yeah, sounds like it.
...of being over here.
Yeah.
Certainly did cause a furor.
And you're spending most of your afternoons in the law library, aren't you?
Oh, yeah, I go up there every day for 3 hours. And,
imagine you're really learning law.
Oh, goodness sakes. Yeah, I'm pretty darn good at this whole process. I won a couple fairly significant victories on Friday, say go last Friday in court. And I suppose that I've learned what the pitfalls of representing oneself are, and so I'm going to avoid those. But for the time being, I am doing the work in the case, and the research, and I think we're pretty successful at, you know, considering the kinds of resources that are amassed against me, and the various law enforcement agencies and prosecutors who are working on this case. I think I'm more than holding my own. I think I'm giving a fit, quite frankly. And I don't. It's not just me. I mean, I'm not here. I'm not. I'm not some genius or anything. I think, but the fact of the matter is, you know, such a rather decrepit case that they're really having a hard time, putting it together, to say the least. I don't know if. You know, they had quote, an eyewitness allegedly had seen me at some place which, you know, fit into their theory of things. And at the preliminary hearing, she looked at me and she looked around the courtroom and picked an undersheriff as the person she had seen. So their case kind of collapsed at that point.
Yeah.
But right now they're, you know, they're hanging in there. I give them credit for me.
Yeah.
So, how are things over there? I've always wondered about you and a lot of my friends there and everything. Mm-hmm. I heard there was a killing not too long ago.
Yeah.